start with is a little story. It's a little story about my mother and her sister when they were children. They lived very close to the Russian border. They lived in a little town called Zilpe in Latvia, and they were very close to the border. In fact, their farm that they lived on, there was a little stream, and the other side of the stream was actually Russia. So the story goes like this. They used to play and go and collect strawberries, and of course the nicest strawberries were on the other side of the little stream. They didn't know they were in Russia. And also their cows sometimes used to wander across the border and they'd have to be fetched back. The cows didn't know it was a border either. So how did they know they shouldn't have been there? Only because their parents said, don't go across there. You shouldn't be across that little stream. They didn't know what a border was. So here, sometimes both sides of the border look exactly the same. The cows didn't know what the difference was between one side and the other, nor did my mother and her sister know what was good on one side and the other. So borders are, to some degree, constructs. They're not things that necessarily are obvious to us. So here I have a picture. Is there a border there? Well, maybe. Maybe not. Can't really tell. Now let's hope this works. So, my question. No, am I going backwards here? Yes, sorry about that. That was the first slide, so we missed one. Anyway, there's the kind of image that I'll start with. That the image is important. There's a border. There's Israel, Syria, Jordan. Again, using that print, the next slide. What is there about that that makes it a border apart from seeing that fence? If the fence wasn't there, would we know there were borders? So, what I want to talk about, and none of those kinds of geopolitical kinds of borders. What I want to do very brief kind of way is to talk about various kinds of ways in which we think about borders. We obviously know that they can be geopolitical boundaries, but they can be more than that. Boundaries can be between cultures, between ideologies, religions, economic regions, and geopolitical blocks, just to name a few. I'm sure some of you who are far cleverer than I can think of many other ways in which we can think about boundaries. So the image I want to begin with really is about boundaries. Okay, so we understand to some extent what a geopolitical border is as one between one country and another. And I think our Dean mentioned at least one way in which we conceive of borders, and that is as natural boundaries. So they can be simply a mountain range, a very high mountain range and very hard to get over, or a very wide river. So those are one way we can think about borders. Think about also in cities. If you have a great big highway dividing two parts of the same neighbourhood, you make a border, a natural border if you like, which separates one side of a country or one side of a city and another. So they're natural. The other kinds of borders are going to be artificial borders. Artificial borders which are defined by cultures, traditions possibly, ethnicity, or they can be imposed by quite arbitrarily, imposed through conquest or international agreement. We know there are many such kinds of borders, especially after World War I. There are a number of borders made in the Middle East, for instance, which are just simply arbitrary. ways in which we can think about borders in terms of just the geopolitical kinds of understanding of a border between countries. And indeed, if you look at the literature, that's what people discuss. Okay, well, what I want to talk about is to try and stretch the idea of borders, and I'll concentrate on that in the rest of what I want to say. So apart from this notion of geopolitical demarcation, and it's a very rich notion that we can use when we talk about the geopolitical notion of borders, we know that borders can be contested, we know that they can be artificial, we know they can be the natural kinds of borders, and they evolve in lots of different ways. So if we think about them in terms of boundaries between countries, that's certainly one understanding of the nature of border. But I want to say, to do something here a little bit different. What I want to do is to stretch, and using some of these terms, to look at other ways in which we can understand borders, and then see what happens when we reconceive of them in these different ways. So here are some ways in which we might be able to talk about them. Boundaries. Now, we've already met boundaries. I've talked about those already in one sense, that we've met that. The boundaries between countries as a kind of fairly obvious way in which we understand borders. So that's one way of thinking. Another way is as limits. Borders are limits of various kinds. And I'll talk more about each of those. Borders can be thought of as partitions. We talk in geopolitical terms, of course. One of the terms that was used in the carving up of India, the partition. Those of you as old as me probably remember that kind of word being used, the partitioning of India. So what did that mean? I mean, India was much bigger once upon a time. They carved off East and West Pakistan. So a partition, walls. And again, there are lots of images about walls as boundaries and as borders. Edges, another way of thinking about borders, edges. And margins. So each of those. Now, these are not exhaustive. These are the ones I could think of. I'm sure if you put your minds to it, there are other ways in which we might conceive of borders. But these are certainly one way of beginning to demarcate our uses of terms and understand certain sorts of things that are expressible as borders and ones that we can reflect on and think about in terms of how we can perhaps move beyond those. So here we are. Now borders, if we look at them in general terms, are markers, and they help to shape the contours of the world in which we live. So we're familiar with them in terms of those physical kinds of definitions, that the extent of my country is defined by this particular notional border, this limit, this boundary. But we also know that borders can be fluid and change according to all kinds of various forces. Wars and conflicts continue basically in the world today, and often there are disputes about where does my country stop and where does my country begin. So this is certainly one of the things about borders, that before we get into a discussion of each of those types, the understanding that they are very fluid. They're not rigid, mostly. And the borders of Romania have shifted over time as well, haven't they? It's not like they've always been like this since time immemorial. And we see in various conflicts in Kashmir, for example, the arguments between Pakistan and India, where the border actually is, and the kinds of fierce fighting that occasionally breaks out about where the border is. If we think about China, sea. Now, what's that doing? It's establishing some kind of borders. And yes, this is Chinese. Other people say, no, it's not. So we have another kind of potential conflict. So we think about lots of places where borders get shifted around. And so they can be dynamic. They are places of contestation. They're not static, mostly. They can be rigid in some cases where we won't allow anything to change. But mostly, they're a bit more fluid. Okay. So in the cases where they're rigid, they'll be saying, well, look, okay, we'll concede that bit of territory, but no more than this. There is a red line. No, we won't let you cross that. We will defend to the death this bit of our territory. So again, here I'm using the imagery from geopolitical borders, but these will apply just as much to some of these other types of things. So let me come to some of these. Okay, so the image of a boundary. Now, here we see a fence, but boundaries exist not just as these kinds of physical fences. They can exist between ethnic groups. So, you know, I might say, yes, well, I like Romanians, but I can't abide Bulgarians. So there's a boundary. So I welcome my Romanian friends with open arms, but Bulgarians, I close them. So there's an ethnic, because they're Bulgarian. I mean, they're Bulgarian. How could I like Bulgarians? Impossible. So why? You might ask, but the point here is that it establishes a boundary. But the other sort of thing is, well, you know, I like Romanians because, well, you know, my uncle is Romanian or something like that, and the auntie I hate is Bulgarian, so I don't like Bulgarians, whatever it is. But I can form a boundary between ethnic groups in that kind of way. Religions, we know religions can be quite significant kinds of boundaries. We don't abide Muslims, for example. Well, we're Christian, we hate Muslims. Well, do we? I don't think Christianity says hate Muslims. So, but religions are a real source of boundaries. Traditions can be boundaries too. We don't do those kind of things. Halloween, for example, is one we've just allegedly celebrated. Halloween, what's that all about? Is this a Romanian tradition? I don't think so. It's not a Latin tradition. And yet, you know, they're beginning to put these things in shops with, you know, pumpkins and things. Anything. What's that all about? So there's a boundary. I don't understand this tradition. Cultures, ideologies, economies, obviously countries and states have boundaries. So I'm mindful of the time, so I'll move on. So this is an understanding of borders as boundaries. So the geopolitical boundaries are a paradigm. The interesting thing is geopolitical boundaries are a recent invention. In the past, there weren't such things. It's only with the development of a modern state. People lived in regions, and they owed allegiance to whoever the regional person was. And there wasn't a big separation between regions. You know, you moved from one region to another, but there was no kind of boundary necessarily, or no kind of border. It was just, there wasn't a modern state, in fact. So you only get boundaries when you get modern state. Natural boundaries, we've mentioned already about ways of delineating different states. Ethnicity is obviously another way of forming a boundary. Here you can see an area in the middle here, just in that light-shaped part, which covers Syria, Iran, and Turkey. That's Kurdistan. The Kurds think they're a nation. Nobody else does. Why not? We can think of some reasons, but the boundaries here, Kurdistan is a kind of place in the middle there, occupied by certain kinds of people, Kurds. But it's not a nation. Here we are. Religion can be a means of establishing borders. Iran is a theocracy. Is Israel a theocracy? Well, it was founded on the basis that the Jews needed their own state after the Second World War, carved out of the existing country there. No wonder we've got continuing fighting. The people who'd been living there all this time said, well, why are you taking over our country? And the Jews are saying, but this is our historical place. So, but these are established on religious grounds. Ideology is a boundary. The Soviet Union is the Soviet Union as it was not so long ago, but certainly within living memory for many people. So it's an ideology. The Iron Curtain divided people. Alright, so that's borders as boundaries. Now, borders as limits. Another way of thinking about borders is as a limit. This is one way of thinking about it, because limits can be described by the extent to which we are tolerant, kind and generous, trusting, caring, sympathetic and empathetic. And there may be some other things to add there as well. But basically, it will express how far we're able to go as being virtuous kinds of people. What are our limits? The sad thing is we aren't unlimited in the way in which we can act virtuously. Fortunately, it probably holds we can't be unlimited in the way in which we can be vicious either. But the point here is that there are limits to how we are generous. You know, you think about it. I gave this beggar some money. There's another one. Oh, give that one some money. And get to the third one. Well, look, I've got no more money. So there's a limit. There's a limit. It could be that I won't give any of them anything because there are limits. All right, so empathy. We can't express empathy unless we actually have experienced grief, for example. I can't grieve with another. I don't know what it is. So there are limits. We are bordered or limited in certain kinds of ways. Confucius points out we can't, we might know what the right thing to do is, and we say the right thing, but there's no warmth, there's no empathy. I'm lacking humaneness. So there's a limit. Okay, borders as partitions. Here, these are separations where the border isn't really that bad. That big. It's not so deep-seated. Christianity, for example, is divided into numbers of different groups. At times they've hated each other quite a bit. I mean, you know, there's nothing like Christians who can hate one another. Terrible, despite being told, love one another. They're pretty good at doing the very opposite that Jesus taught them to do. Roman Catholics, Orthodox Christians and Protestants, all profess to be followers of Christ and yet are divided. But they're not divided by a lot. They're like partitions, which are there as kind of flimsy kinds of divisions. Here's some smaller kinds of partitions, people having offices. It's one way of dividing off people, but they're not particularly major kinds of borders. But they nevertheless exist as ways in which we're separated one from the other. So, walls. Well, obviously, if we have partitions, we can have walls, and walls are much more serious. The Berlin Wall was an example of a serious division and represented a very large gulf between Western democracy and communism as it was practiced in the Soviet Union. So, but this is not the only kind of war. Again, I've used a kind of image from the kind of geopolitical war. But there are, what about gated communities? These are wars. We separate rich from poor. I don't want poor people coming into where I live. So I have a gated community to be protected from all those evil poor people who are outside, and I don't want to show that. What does that scared of them. I'm scared of what they might do. So economic rationalism enables in this country. So there's ideology enabling a war. So the other obvious one is walls as keeping migrants out. These can be physical walls, and people flee countries for different reasons. But the real border isn't the physical wall. The real border is the resentment or the opposition to the hardening of the heart that says, we don't want to welcome these refugees. We don't want them here. Now, I'm not saying we should be necessarily completely open in our borders here, and that we should be opening and welcoming everybody. It may not be possible. Remember, I said there are limits to our generosity. Why are there limits to our generosity? Because in being too generous, we destroy ourselves as well. So that is not necessarily a good thing either for those seeking refuge or those who are accepting people. So, that's the real thing. The real wall is that hardness of heart. So, mental walls are borders. Keep all those people out. And I realise I better stop. I've probably gone over. Edges is another way of thinking about a border. An edge is a limit to what we understand, and there's a horizon. Once we get to an edge, we may be able to see past that edge. I can't be at the cutting edge, that is at the forefront of anything, unless I understand where I have to start. So, the cutting edge idea here. Medicine sans frontières as an example of people who move beyond the edge. They know what they do in their profession, but they move beyond it. They move beyond it. They see the horizon beyond where they are, and they take that step. You can't get beyond the edge if you're sitting in the middle. You have to be at the edge to see where the horizon goes. So that's another border, an edge, and the ability to see beyond. And lastly, borders as margins. So as margins, we understand borders can be vague. We know books have margins. Some books have wider margins than others. The borders are like kind of no man's land. They can be small or large. We say a football match can be won by a narrow margin or a wide margin. What's important is that you won. So when your football team wins 4-0, you think, well, that's great, wonderful. But you'll take it if they win 2-1 or 1-0, as long as you win. So it's the win that's important. So here we have the margin. The margin can be smaller or larger, but there's still a border here. Okay, so borders are larger. Their margins can be larger or smaller. And it's the border between success and failure. They're also ephemeral a little bit. Someone who's homeless lives on the border, in a border land. They live on the margins of society, we sometimes call it. They live in a twilight zone, a no man's land. And it's a border into which the rest of society rarely ventures. To know someone who is homeless, or to know what it feels like, it's a border land that we rarely cross into unless we've had some encounter with the homeless person. So there's a margin. Being in the margins, marginal. We're living in a twilight zone. So here, this is border as a metaphor. There are lots of other ways we might want to conceive of borders, and these are very real in ways just as much as geopolitical borders. They can divide and alienate, but they can be also opportunities for encounter, as we know. People living with disability can be an inspiration to us because they face borders all the time. And the border could be the very doorstep of their apartment or where they live, because there are steps and they are wheelchair and can't go through that. So mental borders, partitions and limits and things like that, we have to overcome those with. So there's the last image in terms of borders. Thank you.